afternoon, everyone. All right.
So the 2017 Golf Business TechCon. I'm Jay Caron. I'm CEO of the NGCOA. And on behalf of the board of directors, staff, and the entire organization, we're very pleased to see you. So the first technology conference that we put on was in 1998 in Atlanta, Georgia. And we had the second TechCon in 1999, and that was the last one that we had. Apparently everybody learned every day in 1998 when 99 wasn't so successful. But we thought just maybe there was been enough time since 1999, that enough time has passed that in the technology world, a few things have happened. You know, we don't like to rush these things, but let me tell you what was happening in the tech space in 1998 and 1999. Apple introduced the iMac. Internet Explorer surpasses Netscape as the market-leading browser. PayPal is founded. Jeff Bezos is Time Man of the Year. TiVo is introduced. The first wikis and blogs show up. The BlackBerry launches. Bluetooth is implemented. David Bowie's Hours becomes the first complete music album by a major artist available to download over the internet before the physical release of the album. And by the way, the same year, the record industry sues Napster. Remember that? And then this little company called Google was incorporated in 1998. Now, did you know that the name of the corporation before was Google was named Backrub? By the way, I suggest that you don't actually Google the term Backrub while you're in Las Vegas. And if you don't know how to erase your browser history, just go see Golf Books Scott Merchant, because I think he has a little practice in that. Now, during that same time period, in golf, our historians tell us that EasyLinks records its first ever online tee time reservation. Several startup tee time companies were founded that year, including Golf Gateway, founded by Brett Darrow, who would later start Cypress Solutions and Golf Now. Golf Switch files for the patent to aggregate tee times from disparate systems. So interesting stuff. We've come a long way. So why host a technology conference? Well, for a few reasons. One, at most conferences in the golf industry, we go a mile wide in each team. And the reason for that is that the business of running a golf course is very comprehensive, so it makes sense that the conferences reflect the comprehensive nature of running an operation. We have to go in all different directions, but we know that we need more time concentrated on technology in this industry. Don't do that important. Number two, by just having this event, whether we have two people show up or 250 people show up, but just by having this event, it's a signal to the entire industry that this is important. When your trade association puts the time and resources into something so singular like this, it's a cue and a signal to the industry that we need to get tech forward instead of tech sitting on our butts. And that's what this is about. And also, three, the vendors in our industry have some amazing things going on, and we wanted a place for you to see it and play with it and touch it and check it out. Right? There's not enough time at other events to do that. So now, personally, I'm a member of Gen X. I have a foot in the past and one in the present and one in the future. I still read newspapers. I even still read print newspapers. Well, the Charleston Post and Courier had a political cartoon the other day, if you don't mind showing that. Toys R Us went bankrupt, which it did, and has three little kids on the side all playing with devices, and someone says, Daddy, what's a toy? Now, the message is clear, isn't it? It doesn't matter if it's iPads and toys or everything around us is changing. Soon, I really believe it'll be, what's a phone, Dad? I mean, look at what Apple came out with the new watch, where you don't need the Bluetooth to your phone anymore. It's directly to the data service and Wi-Fi. Tell you, things are changing fast. If you've been reading my columns and my articles, you know that I'm very bullish about technology in our industry. Whether it's what I believe the golf simulator is as the perfect antidote to the bad weather that we experience in our industry, or the perfect answer to the short golf experience, not to mention food and beverage sales, or the rise of Wi-Fi and beacon technology and GPS and satellite, all the invisible forms of technology that allow us to create this amazing connectivity on the golf course itself. Systems that pull information for the golf. experience, we need to give oxygen, breathe oxygen into what's happening out there. So but in this ecosystem of golfers, and golf course operators, and vendors, I really believe we must give credit to the vendors because they are the tip of the spear when it comes to the technology phenomenon. And we are the users and the subscribers. And we play an important role, there's no question about it. But the vendors around this room, they make it happen. And for that, they have my sincere admiration. And to that end, I'd like to recognize the sponsors of this event. So at first, the presenting level sponsors, these companies really stepped up and made big things happen for us to make this event possible. EasyLinks, Laura and Gary, thank you very much for what you do. Verizon, Scott, Mike and team. USGA, Mike Davis and Hunky and team. PGA of America, Jeff Price, haven't seen Jeff yet, Scott and team. And Golf Genius with Mike Zisman for all that you've done for us. Also our education level sponsors and their support, Golf Zone, Tommy Dunn and Bruce Lucker. On Link with Walt and Scott, thank you for your patronage. And our entertainment level sponsors, DirecTV for Business, George and Eric. Golf Book, Gene and Scott, your support, Tion Golf, Tom, T-Snap, Brian Ward, and the marketing, and T-Sys, Dan. And finally, our networking level sponsors, 18 Birdies, Armando, Criminal Golf, John and Matt, Club Profit, Tom and Rick, Intopia, Tyler, Price Swing, Arnaud, Damien, and Nahum, and To the Green Bob. Let's give our sponsors a big round. Create a relationship and earn business beyond your investment. But if you don't, consider that the difference then is an investment in turning this industry into the nerds and geeks for technology that all of us tend to be. Because we really need it. NGCOE is pushing this. I also want to take a moment to recognize our allied organizations in attendance, the USGA, the National Golf Foundation, Greg Nathan's here, PGA of America. We also have leaders from around the country with our local and regional affiliates from Myrtle Beach to Oregon. Welcome. And to a few international folks, besides the inimitable Lodewijk Kludewig from EGCOA in Amsterdam, welcome. Andrew Davies, all the way from Melbourne, Australia, and the Golf Business Forum, Australia, welcome. David Waters with the club at Cartiglione del Bosco in Montalcino, Tuscany, Italy. I know where we're having the next tech time. And we'll see Mr. Kiwon Park, the CEO of Golf Zone, visiting from South Korea. And of course, Jeff Calderwood and Natalie Love Ali from NGCOE Canada, welcome to the TechCon. And to our speakers and panelists, thank you for the time you put into preparing. I am you many times during the year, and I know and appreciate what you do. And I only get this chance once or twice a year, but I want to publicly thank our staff. Okay, so over the next 2 days, please be sure to say hello. And to the staff, NGCOA, Nancy Downey, Ronnie, Sheree, Michelle, Jay Anderson, Kelly, Sam, Mike Barber, Joe Klein, Holly, and the entire crew that put this together. Thank you for putting up with me and for leaning into NGCOA with me. Let's give the staff. And then also to our board members. A number of them could pull away from their courses at this time of year, but we do have in attendance our Vice President, Dick Stutz, Don Ray, the incomparable Allison George will be among our faculty today. Thank you for all you do. And lastly, our Board President, Rock Lucas. Rock loves a good football analogy. And Rock's in the fourth quarter of his two-year term as president of NGCOA. The clock is winding down, and we have no timeouts left. But I'm glad to report we got some points on the board during his tenure. Rock, come on up for a few comments.
Thank you. shoebox and you run through a punch card reader. Hope you didn't drop the shoebox on the way to the reader, and hope that everything came out right at the end. And then we ended up with floppy disk and hard disk and the DOS guy. And I was a DOS dinosaur. I'm a technology guy. But the only reason I left DOS to go to Windows is because all the software people quit writing anything in DOS. And I love technology, but I'm even slow myself to adapt that. We went from the cigar box that I got for to a cash register, to a computerized cash register, to a point of sale system, web, online booking, all of these things. And my goal in life is to work my way back to the cigar box. I want my business to be so good, so down pat, that I don't have to use all this technology anymore. But unfortunately, that's not going to happen. Make sure I don't miss anything else here. I wouldn't be here today, like a lot of operators in the room. If you're in this room and you're an operator, you're a survivor. You have to be good at what you're doing, or else you would not be here today, unless you're just getting into the business and you're new to business. And I personally owe a debt of gratitude to the people that I've met through this association, because we would not be in business with the hundreds of thousands of dollars of education, consulting, shoulders to cry on, visits to my property to help us make decisions to better us. And what my goal out of this conference today is, or this next couple of days, is to take us, we've survived. It's still tough, we're survived. But to take us to a whole other level and to up our game, and to use the technology that we learned here today to up it. Now, I'm going to shut up. And again, I'm going to thank our staff. Jay did. Jay, it's a great idea to do this conference. You know, when we first started, I'd be 100% honest, probably shouldn't say what I'm saying, but they know better to give me a microphone, but I'm going to say it anyway. Our board said, well, Jay, you got on your plate. You know, maybe we shouldn't do this. Well, Jay already started down the road. And I'm glad that they did. Look at this room. It was a sold-out event. It was a great decision. You know, 18 years is too long for, you know, to go for technology. So we did it. We couldn't have done it without, one, you being here, two, our sponsors, the hard work from our staff. And I just want to thank them so much. Jay's already got a round of applause for him. Hopefully it'll be, you know, won't be 18 years before we do it again. Now I'm going to shut up and get to the education and introduce our co-chairs, Dale Ratcliffe, President of Ratcliffe Golf Services, Mike Zisman with Golf Genius. Mike, I'm going to give you a word of advice. Dale's a heck of an operator, but Dale is even better North Carolina moonshiner and Vegas gambler. When your grandma teaches you to gamble at 8 years old, he knows his way around. One piece of advice for Mike. Last time I was here, I was chairman of the Golf Industry Show. Never been here before. My wife wants to go see the Palmer Place. Jay, Dale
say a few words to us then.
Alright, so no one really noticed, but I quickly switched over to my iPad and got rid of the paper.
There's someone in there.
They want to be out showing there. So thank you so very much for having me here today. As mentioned, I am in charge of manufacturing and automotive verticals for wireless. And you know, you kind of stop and think, well, why does that have to do with this business? And if you think about whether you're Boeing or Caterpillar or Northrop Grumman, you all have different solutions that you're trying to solve, and those can be boiled down to three different categories. It is improving your operations, improving your revenue, and improving your customer experience. And those customers have the exact same experiences and challenges that you are facing with today. So I'd like to talk with you a little bit about IoT. IoT stands for Internet of Things. It used to be called M2M, and back in 1999 and 1998, it used to be called telematics. And IoT just stands for devices that are sending and receiving data via the Internet. And the reason it changed from machine to machine over to IoT is because now you're seeing changes in the cost structure as well as in the cost to transmit the data that make it cheap enough that you can see it on all sorts of devices, not just actual machines. But before we get into that, let me give you a little commercial. I promised Ronnie it would be really brief, but the reason Verizon is in the IoT business is because of really who we are. So hopefully everyone knows of us as the wireless folks. That's our bread and butter. But on top of that, then we have a business section that is global, 150 different countries that are providing IoT cloud and cybersecurity solutions. And then we also have Fios, which makes us one of the top 10 cable providers in the nation, which that's kind of cool, right? It gives us access to some media and some other place in there. The other thing that we've done is we've recently bought out, going back to 1998-99, we bought out AOL.
Woohoo!
Okay. Get ready for those CDs to come in the mail. No, I'm kidding. And we bought out Yahoo, and we combined those two companies into a new company called Hope. And the reason that we did that is so that we have access to media that we can present on what we call OTT, which is over the top, providing media and entertainment through wireless connections. It also gives us a new avenue into marketing, especially going into a millennial business. AOL has one of the best take rates for millennial marketing that there is in the world. So we're very excited to add those folks to the family. And then earlier this year, we bought out a company called Telogis. And Telogis and Fleetmatics is now made us the world's largest provider of fleet solutions, as well as mobile resource management. So the reason I tell you all of that is because all of those pieces come together in the new world of IoT. So with that, I'm just going to play a real quick video and give you an idea of some of the things that IoT is doing today.
Providing all sorts of unique solutions in all sorts of unexpected places to make the world smarter and our customers' lives better. We're connecting sensors to make farms more sustainable by helping them save water and power, and keep your food and pharmaceuticals safe by making sure shipments arrive on time at the right temperature. We're making almost every car smarter and every driver safer with a simple plug-in device. We're using connected infrastructure like lampposts to make cities smarter, safer, and more efficient. We're using our expertise in network, data analytics, and cloud to help major companies work smarter. When it comes to digital media and entertainment, our Go90 app offers original shows and major league sports. We're evolving our Fios platform to next-generation video delivery, bringing together the brands people love in sports, news, entertainment, and finance. And, of course, we provide the best networks in the business, 4G LTE, Fios, and soon, next-generation 5G wireless, all powered by one of the largest fiber networks in the world.
Okay, that was the extent of my commercial, promise. The rest of it now is just going to be talking from a very high level of what IoT does. And if you, speaking of IoT or machine-to-machine, whatever you want to call it, there's a lot of different surveys out there, and whether you're Ericsson or Nokia or Gartner, whoever you want to look at, IoT is getting ready to explode. There's some saying 7 is probably a drop in the bucket when you think of the fact that you have TVs, refrigerators, dishwashers, cars, and they're all connected now as well. So what are some of the things that are stopping people from getting into IoT, getting into machine-to-machine? Security, interoperability, costs, and lack of standards. Those are probably the big four drivers. And I'll tell you that whether you're working with us or someone else, we're trying to eliminate a lot of those barriers for you. You're seeing development of IoT thresholds, whether it's using Apple or Google, or Verizon or Amazon or AT&T, which are trying to take a lot of the complexity out of connecting your devices in the field. The other thing that you're seeing is a real quick drop in the cost, the barrier to entry for the cost. So as we moved over to LTE, we saw a division in the amount of types of chipsets that were created. There's four basic chipsets depending on the amount of data and the amount of power that you want to use. So now, if you look at the bottom piece there, the NB-IoT chipset, which stands for Narrowband IoT chipset, what that does is it's a very low power, very low bandwidth chipset that you can apply. And then you think, well, okay, what's that great for? Well, what happens if I want to weave it into clothing or put it on shoes or someday attach it to a golf ball? We're getting to a price point where those are now feasible ideas. One of our customers, Baked Bread, they're a big bread manufacturer. They're out of, North or South Carolina, if I remember correctly. And the biggest problem that they have right now for talking about operational efficiency is those big plastic trays that you see the delivery guys loading the breads up and they drop it off at the grocery stores. Those trays get stolen on a regular basis. Who knew that? Who knew even crossed my mind? It's $1 billion problem for people that are delivering in the food service industry. $1 billion problem. The trays are getting stolen because they're sent down to someplace down south and they get shipped and then they're sold to recycling manufacturing. So what this customer wants to do is be able to put a chipset on every one of those trays. Guess how many trays that one manufacturer has? Throw out a number. 300,000. Well, that's close. It's about 500,000 trays that they go through a year. Can you imagine 500,000 connections? Now, stop and think, 150,000 connections for every man, woman, and child, and there's 500,000 a year in just one customer solution. So what is the scale of all this stuff? Here's some kind of, a quick peek at some of the things that we're thinking about. If you look at the utilities, there's 360 million devices out there for utility customers. 360 million. So every one of those connections to your home, to your business, to your office could have at some point an IoT connection on it. If you think about it in the supply chain with transportation, as mentioned, I've got the automotive, all the automotive manufacturers are my responsibility. And then you've got 150 million cars that are out on the street. And thanks to Elon Musk, what's everyone trying to do? They're all rushing to be the first automated vehicle. And do you know what, for me, one of the most interesting things that they worry about is if you're in a no-win situation where someone's going to have to die, who dies? The person in the car or the person on the street? Those are the ethical issues that they're having to deal with as you get into autonomous vehicles. And that's amazing to me. I mean, that would never cross my mind that those are the kind of discussions. IoT plays into that because they need to have real-time updates of what's going on every minute of those scenarios. So if you take a look at what we're doing and some of the other companies are looking at too, we've broken IoT into six major categories. And really what we're doing is looking at it from a utility perspective, looking at it from a supply chain perspective, from food and safety, from what we'll call share, and then of course the automated vehicles. Let's start out real quick with share. Share solutions, has anyone heard of Cardigo? So share solutions is basically utilizing untapped resources that you've got. Maybe they're sitting idle. I'm from Minnesota. Anyone from Minnesota?
So you guys are kind of a tough crowd here. Come on.
All right. So a few Minnesotans. Good, good. So state of Minnesota used to be one of my customers. They lost a backhoe. I don't know. How do you lose a backhoe? As a state taxpayer, doesn't that frustrate you a little bit? They lost it. It might have fallen in the lake, you never know. But what happened is they lost the backhoe, so they had to go and buy another one. All right, so that's a whole layer of problems there onto itself. Now imagine I put a little when that backhoe is sitting big or sitting idle at night, and maybe there is a construction crew who's got a night project going on, could I use shared technology allowing my phone to authorize who I am to electrically start the backhoe, to run the backhoe, to do a point of sale transaction for me, and then to confirm that the backhoe has been returned? Could I turn that into a revenue opportunity for the state or for another construction company? Possibly. That's what the shared economy is all about, and that's one of the things that we're working with our customers to provide. Taking a look at smart community solutions, smart community is basically putting in an IoT connection on every street light, every sign, post, every street corner that you can think of, and providing data about how the pedestrians are acting, how the cars are acting, what's happening in the city. Now, as a concert is letting out, we can actually turn on the lights and change the course of those people leaving a concert hall. Maybe bad weather is coming. We can send out alerts through a streetlight to say, hey, take shelter, tornado's on its way, and maybe save lives. Smart cities is going to completely revolutionize the world. We're currently in contract with about 11 different cities, and I'd like to say altruistically, we're doing this out of the goodness of our heart to provide the city of Boston and others with important information. But what we're really doing is we're using this to fast track building out Ethernet connections to all the streetlights so that we can put up small cells on 5G. So has anyone heard about 5G? All right, a few. Okay, so that's the next generation wireless technology that's coming out, and that's going to make 4G look like you're standing still. It's going to be a lot faster and a lot more game-changing. We're building that network to take 1 billion connections, and that's just here in the United States. So that's kind of, once again, the scale of how IoT is really starting to take off. Grid-wide, we already talked about that, what people are doing for grid utilities. Does anyone have a connected utility monitor on your business or on your own? No? A couple people? So in California, Southern Edison is working with, SoCal Edison is working with their customers that if you put a Nest thermostat on your house, which is an M2M connection, an IoT connection, you can actually get a discount off their prices. So that's where we're able to control operational efficiency. We know what the true demand of the electrical need is with all the connected houses, and then we can provide a better customer experience by giving a refund to the customers. That's on the consumer side, and I can only imagine what they're doing on the corporate side. And then one of the things that I think is really interesting is the ag solution. So, as I mentioned, I'm from Minnesota, and right next door to us is North and South Dakota. Anyone from North and South Dakota? Man, you're a tough crowd. No Dakotans? Huh? All right, so who wants to live in South Dakota? Exactly. Now, imagine you're a farmer, you've got 200 acres, and you've got to fertilize that field. Who's going to help you fertilize that field? Because how many of you raise your hands, you want to live in South Dakota? That's a problem, right? It's a real challenge that they've got in both North and South Dakota is what do we do when we don't have the capital, when we don't have the people to help us do our business? They rely on technology to transform how their business is going. And the smart connected farm is probably one of the first steps in revolutionizing how they're doing that. And when you have fewer and fewer people living out there, you have to rely more on this. With smart tech or smart ag, you're able to control water, you're able to control fertilizer, you're able to control runoff, you're able to control did we send the right feed to the right hog. So I was talking with a co-op owner, and apparently there is medicated hog feed for certain hogs, and if you put the wrong hog feed in the wrong hog trough, you have to basically segment out those hogs until the FDA has proven that hog is safe again. And this is costing co-ops thousands and thousands of dollars. Now, I can have someone who is probably low skill and is probably not really wanting to do the job in the first place. Now, with IoT, I can sit there and have a bright red or green light on the feed truck and says, push green button now and deliver the food, and I don't have to worry about that $10,000 mistake that's just made. Or talking with a large ag company out of St. Louis, it's a $100,000 mistake every time you mix the chemicals that they use to make fertilizer and spread it on the field, because if it's not mixed exactly correctly, that fertilizer is actually poisoned.
saying, are you mixing this correctly? Yes, it has been mixed correctly. Are you distributing it correctly across the field? And that's where I think that you're getting into something similar along the lines of what you can do with your golf courses. One of the other big things that's really starting to take off is drone industry. So does anyone have a drone? All right, there's a few hands. See, there's a few early adopters. All right, I like that. Good. So do you use the drones for anything for fun, or do you use it for work? Some of the drone things.
Highly guarded locations.
Okay, excellent. So you're checking from high above to say, hey, this is a dry area, increased watering and lowering watering. You check in water runoff and everything like that. All right. This is the tip, and what made you decide to do that?
I work for a golf association. It's for Park and Coral.
Another good Minnesota company. And so you came up with the idea on your own, or they encouraged you?
Just by the breadth of what technology encompasses. You know, it really is such a broad topic that it's just impossible.
impossible for us to cover something like that. If we took a week or longer, we probably didn't touch on everything that we really need to touch on with that. But having said that, we're going to go ahead and get started with our education sessions now. And before we do that, I've been given a couple of house cleaning things that I want to take care of. First of all, it has to do with our internet connections. As a matter of fact, speaking of internet things and everything, this is a technology conference, so I'm sure, does anybody here want to be connected to the internet while you're here? Well, unfortunately, we don't have any kind of connection for you. Sorry about that. We didn't want to spend that money. But I'm just kidding. We've got it, actually. It's, you can go to the actual, let's see, that's the password on that right there. Okay, the ID, if you look for the signal on your phone, it's the GB TechCon, and the password is TechCon17, capital T, and capital C, TechCon17. So you can actually get the, that's actually a good service. We've checked it out in all the rooms and everything. So you should be able to get on the internet. Some sessions you're actually going to be wanting to get on the internet while the session is going on, which is a really great thing. We're wanting to actually have some hands-on use of technology. We're going to be asking you to download some things. We're going to be asking you to work on some projects for your own properties. And so it might be important for you to have that. So I would encourage you to make sure that you check that connection and get it working on any devices that you might have. You're welcome to bring those devices to any of the sessions. You're welcome to bring laptops, anything that you want to bring in to use and help you get more out of the sessions, please feel free to do so. Between 3:30 and 4 p.m., we're going to have a networking break. We'll be right back in this room right here. That's going to be a great time for you to come in, grab some refreshments, spend some more time with some of our vendors. You might have some questions that you've had stimulated by some of the sessions that you've been attending. And then, after we get through with that, we'll go into our second block of education. And that second block of education will continue until 5:45. And then at the conclusion of the afternoon's education, we'll invite you one last time to reconvene into this room, and we'll have a happy hour and another sponsored meet and greet. Now, I can tell you, I would highly encourage you, if you've never been to one of our events like this, spend time with the sponsors, the vendors, the other attendees. I can tell you from my own experience, these are great people. It's hard to actually do business and be a customer with everybody in the room, but I can tell you I've worked with almost all of them in here, and over the years have become great personal friends with them. And there's not a single person in this room that isn't willing to help you in your business. If you've got a question on anything that has to do with technology, I can guarantee you that someone here is not only going to be able to help you, they will be very willing to help you with that. So we're going to be going into the breakout sessions next. And they start over here. We've actually got the meetings that are going into Starvine 12. We have Starvine 2. And I've actually got, I'm going to pull my glasses out here so I can make sure that I get this, because I've even got this for the different ones that we want to attend. All right, in Starvine 2, Allison George. Where's Allison? Hold up your hand, Allison. Oh, she was in here. She might already be over there. Where is she? Oh, here she is. Okay, Allison's going to be leading the sessions in Starvine 2. She's going to be doing an overview to kick off the marketing-focused education. Then if you want to attend Allison's social media basics session, you'll remain in that room following her introduction. If you want to go to the website basics section, you'll need to move over to Starvine 12. All right, for those that are interested in the operations track, please make your way to Starvine 13, where Mike Ziesman, who was up here with me earlier, is going to be delivering a brief overview to set the stage for the operations-oriented education. And after that, Joel Rager with 4UP and Matt Welliver with Chronogolf will lead a session titled Getting More Out of Your Point-of-Sale System. Obviously, you're free to attend the classes in either or both of these tracks. You can switch back and forth. You're not committed to one. We've tried to group educational offerings so that you really can select a particular track and stay in that track, but don't feel like you have to do that. Finally, I want to point out that we will have three sessions going on at all times, so it's going to be really difficult. You won't be able to attend all three, obviously. But what we are going to be doing is we'll be recording these sessions. As an attendee, you're going to have access to those recordings after the conference, free of charge, so you won't feel like you're losing out on anything. If you happen to miss one of the sessions in the other rooms, don't worry about that. You will have access to those recordings, and that's something that's really good. I'll tell you, I've talked with a lot of people. I actually download recordings when we do things like this onto my phone, hook it up to Bluetooth in my truck when I'm going into work, and you can sit there and listen to the sessions that you didn't listen to. And it's a lot of fun. It's very educational and really makes me feel like I get a lot out of these. So with that, I'm going to let everybody go off and learn how to streamline your operations and turn to charge your marketing. Good luck.
We still got on camera. I was wondering if I could back up.
Cool. All right. I want to hear, I'll set this one up in there, but Mike's already started on his. And that recorder,
I got to go.
Oh, you did? Okay.
I'll bring this one in there right now. Thank you, Dale, man.
Sure.